To all the dear brothers and sisters who are assembled here. I thank my Heavenly Father and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for giving me this wonderful opportunity to stand before His holy saints. And to serve His dear flock. I also thank the Ecclesia elders for giving me this wonderful opportunity to serve you all. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, I first of all bring the greetings of all the Ecclesia members. In Bangalore. And my family members. My mother.
My mama.
And my wife, Sister Usha. Now let us move on to the subject. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, generally when we are studying something, from the Bible, we choose a good example and study. But we will not choose a bad example for our study. But today we will study a bad example from the Bible. Because the Bible says that the scriptures are given to make us wise unto salvation. That every scripture is the inspiration of God. If this is the case, then there must be some good lesson even in a bad example. So today we will study one bad example from the Bible. Can anybody tell one bad example from the Bible? King Saul. Good. Any other? I want the best of all the bad example. Very good. That's my subject today. Today we are going to study about our adversary. How Lucifer was. How he sinned against God. What made him to sin against God. So how is God going to deal with Lucifer? And how is Lucifer going to be destroyed? That is our subject today. Can anybody tell me where the Bible speaks about Lucifer in complete detail? Isaiah 14 chapter. Good. Apart from that one? Okay. You can see the chart and copy your answer. It's also given in Ezekiel 28 in great detail. I hope that everybody are able to see the chart. So let us all open our Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 28 verses 11 to 19. I request somebody to read verses 11, 12, 13 and 14.
Идет мне слово Пана Тейтрещи. Сыну Словеча, за мной спеши животу над крылем тиру и повест му. Так мови предмостный Пан. Ты, который былеш отвечен досконалощи, певным и мудрощи, искату не допенкна. Былеш в Эдене, о гроде Божьем. Открытием твоим были вшелаки други камене, карнеол, топаз и ясид, хризолит, берил и оник, шафир, рубин и шмарак. Ze złota zrobione były Twoje dębenki, a Twoje ozdoby zrobione w dniu, gdy zostałeś stworzony. Obok cheruba, który bronił wstępu, postawiłem się.
Okay, that's sufficient. This verse tells about King Tyrus, King of Tyrus. And that he was in Garden of Eden. And he was a cherub. And do we all believe that King of Tyrus was in Garden of Eden? Was he a cherub? No. We all know very well that King of Tyrus was neither in Garden of Eden nor was he a cherub. Then who is this cherub who was in Garden of Eden? This is nothing but Lucifer. Therefore, these verses are speaking about Lucifer. And this verse, verse number 12, also says that Lucifer was full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Which means that means there was no manufacturing defect when God created Lucifer. When God created Lucifer, God created him perfect. This verse also tells that Lucifer was perfect in beauty. What is this beauty that is given to us in verse 13? I ask somebody to read verse 13.
Okryciem swoim były wszelakie drogie kamienie, karneol, topaz i jaspis, chryzolit, beryl i onyks, szafir, rubin i szmaragd. Ze złota zrobione były twoje bębenki, a twoje ozdoby zrobione w dniu, gdy zostałeś stworzony.
So here we see that Lucifer was decorated with different types of precious stones. Can somebody tell me how many precious stones are written there?
Nine.
That's correct. That is the Navratna. Navratna. This is the ring which generally people wear. This is one of the trademark of adversary. So what does all these stones mean? Each and every stone has a meaning. Each and every stone has a particular quality. And a particular character. Therefore, even today, many people like to wear diamond, thinking that it will give them a happy life. Similarly, these nine stones represent nine important characters which was in Lucifer when God originally created him. So what are the meaning of these nine stones? Let us study about these nine stones within a few minutes. Can somebody tell me what is the name of the first stone? Okay, no problem. I will tell it in my translation. King James Version. Okay?
King James.
The first stone is Sardis.
You can see
on the chart here. Sardis is a red stone. In olden days, they used to use this stone to heal the wound. Similarly, the whole mankind was wounded by sin. And God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus, to save the world. This shows God's love towards mankind. Therefore, this stone, Sardis, represents love. Did Lucifer have love within him? Yes, Lucifer had this love when God originally created him. It is one of the essential quality anybody requires to live among the angels. It is an essential quality for anybody to live among the angels. Therefore, we read in the Bible in 1 Corinthians 13th chapter, 13th verse.
13.
That now abideth faith, hope, charity. But the greatest of all is charity. When we are on this side of the veil, we have faith on God that we will one day see the invisible God. We have hope that we shall receive our reward. We should also have love of the brethren. But when we are on the side of the veil, our faith and our hope are fulfilled. The only thing which we require everywhere is love. Therefore, Lucifer had this quality of love in him. The second stone is called as topaz. Topaz, this stone, when rubbed vigorously, used to produce electrostatic charges. Spiritually, this would mean the transmission power of the grace of the Holy Spirit. And Lucifer, who was one of the morning stars, had this grace in him. In his words and in his actions. Therefore, the second stone topaz would represent grace. And the third stone is called as diamond in the King James Version. But it is a wrong translation in KJV. It should actually be rock crystal. Because of its fixed vibrating frequency. This stone is used in communicating equipment. Spiritually, this would mean that these are messengers of God. Therefore, we read in the Bible that angels are sometimes called as messengers of God. And Lucifer was one such messenger. Therefore, the third stone would represent the messengers of God. The fourth stone is called as beryl. In Ezekiel, first chapter, Ezekiel is shown a vision of a living creature. That living creature was having four different faces. You can read that one in Ezekiel, first chapter, 10th verse.
Ich oblicza wyglądały u wszystkich czterech z przodu jak twarz ludzka. Z prawej strony jak twarz lwa, z lewej strony jak twarz wołu, a z tyłu jak twarz orła.
The face of a man.
Twarz tego, tej postaci.
The face of a lion.
Głos jak, jak lisa lwa.
The face of an ox. And the face of an eagle. And by the side of this living creature, there was a wheel. And the appearance of the wheel was like unto a beryl. That is given to us in verse 15 and 16.
A gdy spojrzałem na żywe istoty, oto na ziemi obok każdej ze czterech żywych istot było koło. A wygląd kół i ich wykonanie były jak chryzolit i wszystkie cztery miały jednakowy kształt. Tak wyglądały i tak były wykonane, jakby jedne koło było w drugim.
Czy? It was...
Mamy tylko różnicę tłumaczeń. W wersji angielskiej jest to beryl, a tutaj mamy tak chryzolit w warszawski, poznański. A tibetański mówi, że jest to tarczy. Więc nie ma tych wspomnianego beryl, jest to tylko w wersji angielskiej, tak.
Okay. This wheel was like unto a beryl. Can somebody tell me what are these four living, what are the four faces of a living creature? What does it mean? Can somebody tell me? This represents the four important attributes of God. Can somebody tell me the four important attributes of God? Justice, love, power, wisdom. So these are the four important attributes of God. And these important attributes of God are revealed to the people of this earth through this wheel. So what are these wheels? These wheels are the cycles. The ages. The dispensations. In the divine plan of the ages. It is to the divine plan of the ages that mankind comes to know about God's important characters. So what does the divine plan of the ages show to us? It shows the height and depth, length and breadth of God's wisdom. Therefore, this stone beryl would represent wisdom. And we read in the Bible that in Ezekiel that Lucifer was full of wisdom. This is the fourth stone. The fifth stone is sardonyx. In some translations, it's given as onyx. And this stone has three layers. A black base, a middle white layer, and a top red layer. So what does black represent in the Bible? Black represents trial, tribulations and sufferings. Now can somebody tell me why does God allow tribulations in our life? What does the Bible say about it? Tribulation worketh patience. Romans 5th chapter 3rd verse. Therefore, this black stone would represent humbleness. What does the white mean in the Bible? White represents holiness and purity. What does red represent in the Bible? Red. Red means sin and death. Therefore, these three colors in one stone, three in one, would mean three in one quality. To remain holy and humble unto death. When God created Lucifer, God had given this ability to Lucifer to remain humble and holy till his death. But Lucifer failed to maintain that position. This is the fifth stone. Now the sixth stone is jasper. Now what does jasper mean in the Bible? In Revelation 4th chapter 3rd verse we see that one who sat upon the throne was like unto a jasper. Okay. So what does this mean? How is our Heavenly Father? What does His Son Jesus Christ say about His Father? In Matthew 5:48, He tells that be you perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. If you want, you can read that verse. Matthew
5:48.
Therefore, Heavenly Father is perfect. Therefore, jasper would represent perfection. And we read in the Bible that Lucifer was created perfect. This is the sixth stone. The seventh stone is sapphire. Sapphire is a blue stone. Can somebody tell me what is the meaning of blue in the Bible? Blue represents faithfulness. Okay, the sky is blue in color. That shows the faithfulness of God towards mankind. In that, He gives rain and sunshine to both the evil and the good. Therefore, sapphire would represent faithfulness. So, was Lucifer faithful? Yes, Lucifer was faithful to God. For how many years was he faithful to God? Can somebody tell me approximately for how many years was Lucifer faithful to God? Can somebody tell me? God created for how many days? How many days? 6 days. He rested on the seventh day. What is the period of each creative day? Ah, 7,000 years. Very good. 7,000 into 6 days. How many? 42,000 years. Lucifer was faithful to God for how many years? Minimum 42,000 years. That is the seventh stone. Sapphire. The next stone is emerald. Emerald is a green stone. What does green mean in the Bible? Green means everlasting life. The life of a mankind now is compared to a grass. But the life of the mankind during the 1,000 years. Life of a mankind during the 1,000 years. Is compared to a tree. Grass will stay in the morning, it will go off in the evening. But tree will live for 100 to 200 years. More years. Longer period. Okay. This tree lives for a longer period. Okay. Therefore, green represents everlasting life. Lucifer was given the opportunity to have everlasting life. But he sinned against God and lost that opportunity. You can write down some verses if you want. Isaiah 65:22 and Isaiah 40th chapter 7th verse. This is the 8th stone. The last stone is carbuncle. In some of the Bibles, it is called as chalcedony. Okay. It is found hidden in the copper mines. When it is put into terrific heat and cut and polished, this stone gives out its beauty. Similarly, when we are chosen from the copper mines of this earth, and put into fiery trials, what should we show to God? When we are put into fiery trials, what should we show to God? How should we behave? We should show perfect obedience and submission to God. Therefore, this last stone would represent submission. Lucifer also was submissive to God in the initial stages. Was submissive. Initial stages. In the beginning. Therefore, Lucifer had these 9 important qualities in him. Can somebody tell me all the 9 qualities? Already gone to sleep. Can somebody tell me? Okay. The first stone is Sardis. Love. Topaz means grace. Diamond means messengers of God. Beryl means wisdom. Sardonyx means humble and holy. Onyx. Jasper means perfection. Sapphire means faithfulness. Emerald means everlasting life. Carbuncle means submission. Lucifer was completely filled with all these qualities. Then why did he sin against God? What made him to sin against God? That is given in Ezekiel 28 chapter 15, 16, 17. Can somebody read that one in your Bible? Ezekiel 28:15-16-17.
Nienagannym byłeś w postępowaniu swoim od dnia, gdy zostałeś stworzony, aż dotąd, gdy odkryto u ciebie niegodziwość. Przy rozległym swoim handlu napełniłeś swoje wnętrze gwałtem i zgrzeszyłeś. Wtedy to wypędziłem cię z góry Bożej, a Herod, który bronił wstępu, wygubił cię spośród kamieni ognisty. Twoje serce było wyniosłe z powodu twojej piękności. Zniweczyłeś swoją mądrość skutkiem swojej świetności. Zrzuciłem cię na ziemię, postanowiłem cię przed królami, aby się z ciebie naigrywali.
In verse 17 it tells, thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. And thou hast corrupted thy wisdom. This is the reason that Satan sinned against God. It is the pride in his heart. Because of all these wonderful, beautiful characters, Lucifer's heart was lifted up in pride. Therefore, he sinned against God. God created Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and gave the whole dominion of the earth to those people and made Lucifer to be the watchman over these people. But Lucifer could not humble himself to such an extent. Even to be a watchman over a lower creation. Therefore, he was lifted up in pride. Just imagine you are the manager of a big company. manager.
And
everybody is saluting you. And from tomorrow onwards, your boss will come and tell you, you are no more the manager of the company. But you should work as a watchman. How would you feel? Daily. Evil thoughts will come in our mind. To do some harm to our boss. It was the same thought that motivated Lucifer to sin against the Most High. It is then that he thought, as recorded in Isaiah 14, chapter 13th verse, that I will ascend unto heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds and be like the Most High. It is then that he sinned against God. We can read that one in Ezekiel 28:18. Ezekiel 28:18, verse 18.
Dlatego wywiodłem z Ciebie ogień I ten Cię strawił. Obróciłem Cię w popiół na ziemi na oczach wszystkich, którzy Cię widzieli.
Though has defiled the sanctuary by the multitude of the iniquities, by the iniquity of the traffic, it is because of the iniquity of his traffic, he defiled his sanctuary.
Wszystko obrało się na to, przechodzić jedno po drugim.
Because of pride, he got defiled. Therefore, what would God do to Lucifer? That is given in verse 18. It tells, therefore God will bring a fire from himself that would destroy him and will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. What is the meaning of this verse? Where God tells that God will bring a fire from himself. This fiery ambition that was in Lucifer to be somebody great. God did not quench it immediately. But allowed it to grow. So that one day his own fiery desire shall consume him. This verse also tells how Satan shall be destroyed in the little season. It tells in my Bible, therefore I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. Which means that Lucifer shall be destroyed in the sight of everybody on the earth. In the little season. But the Russell tells in one of his volumes. During the little season. Say Lucifer will be given the opportunity to manifest himself in the flesh. And once he manifests himself in the flesh, he shall be locked in that nature and never allowed to go back to the spiritual realm. Even as it happened in the first world, end of the first world. During the flood, Lucifer and the fallen angels escaped from the earth atmosphere. But they were never taken back to heaven. They were locked in the outer darkness. Similarly, in the little season, Lucifer shall be locked in this human nature. And it is then that the fire shall come out from heaven and destroy him in sight of everybody. Why would God do such a thing? Why God wants Lucifer to be destroyed in the sight of everybody? That is given in Ezekiel
28:19.
All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee, thou shall be a terror, and never thou shall be any more. All the people shall be astonished and very much surprised. When Lucifer, who was one of the morning star, the initial creations of God, God himself pronounced him that he is very good, could fall into such a depth of sin just because of one thing. That thing is pride. He had all the qualities in him up to the mark, 100%. But he sinned against God just because of one reason. That is pride. All the mankind will realize the pride is a thing which God doesn't like. And he shall be the terror of second death. Everybody will realize that if we develop such a pride in our life, we shall go to second death. For this reason, God has set Lucifer as an example in the Bible. Therefore, there are seven things which are abomination in the sight of God. Can anybody tell me what is the first thing which God doesn't like? Very good. Where does the verse come? Can somebody tell me? Open. Which one?
Proverbs.
Correct. Open. Proverbs 6th chapter, 12th verse. You are all very good Bible students. It's very interesting to take subject to people like you, where we interact with each other. or else it will be boring for me also. Or else it will be boring for me also. You also sleep, allow me also to sleep. Read Proverbs 6th chapter 12th verse. Okay, the first thing is the first thing is a proud look. Looking as if, oh, what can he do? What can we do? I am the greatest. That look God doesn't like. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, Lucifer is compared to precious stones in the Bible. But is there anybody else who is compared to precious stones in the Bible? Where did you copy that answer? Okay, that's given in Revelation 21st chapter. You are smart Bible student. If I ask the same question to anybody, immediately seeing the chart, they will tell it is Jesus Christ. You are the first person to tell that a church is compared to stones in the Bible. Revelation 21st chapter 19th verse.
Kamienie węgielne muru miasta były ozdobione wszelakimi drugimi kamieniami. Kamień pierwszy to jaspis, drugi szafir, trzeci chalcedon, czwarty szmaragd, piąty sardonyx, szósty karneol, siódmy chryzolit, ósmy beryl, dziewiąty topaz, dziesiąty chryzopras, jedenasty hiacynt, dwunasty ametyst.
So, here we can see the city was garnished with precious stones. Which is this city? This is the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven. And it was decorated with how many stones? 12 stones were there. It was upon the foundation of these stones, it was on the foundation of this city that it was decorated with 12 stones. Can somebody tell me who is the foundation of this city?
God.
Primary, it is our Lord Jesus Christ. Then the apostles. It is upon this foundation called Jesus Christ. That we build our character. Read that one in 1 Corinthians 3rd chapter 11th verse. See? Foundation is Jesus Christ. Next, continue. 12th verse.
A czy ktoś na tym fundamencie wznosi budowę ze złota, srebra, drogich kamieni, z drzewa, siana, słomy?
Okay. It is upon this foundation that somebody built with precious stones. Then verse 13.
To wyjdzie na jaw w jego dziele. Dzień sądny bowiem to pokaże, gdyż ognie się objawi.
Every man's work shall be tried with fire. Even our precious character, which are like stones. Shall be tried with fire. Fiery trials will tell us of what sort we are. So if we come back to Revelation, they were actually 12 stones. You can see on that side of the chart. What is the difference between the Lucifer and the church? What is the difference? How many difference?
Three more
difference. So let us study what are the three difference which Lucifer doesn't have and which the church is having. In Revelation 21:19, the first stone is jasper. We already know that jasper represents perfection. The church is imperfect. Though the church is imperfect, God is perfecting the church. Perfecting the church. In the first resurrection. The second stone is sapphire. Sapphire represents faithfulness. Until and unless. We are faithful unto death. We cannot receive the crown of life, correct? Revelation 2nd chapter 10th verse. The third stone is chalcedony. That means submission. We need to submit to God completely. The fourth stone is emerald. Emerald means everlasting life. The everlasting life which the church is promised is the divine nature. The nature which God Himself is having. By any chance, if we are faithful, God will give His own nature to us. We will be individual gods. Individual, separate gods. We ourselves will be a god. This is the everlasting life the church is promised. The fifth stone is sardonyx. That means humble and holy unto death. The sixth stone is sardis, which means love. The seventh stone is chrysolite. Chrysolite in olden days, they used to use the stone to cure some disease in the eyes. So what does eyes mean in the Bible? Eyes means eyes of understanding. In the Bible, we read that after Adam sinned against God, his eyes were opened. Does it mean that he was wearing cooling glass? Or did God create him in blind? No. His spiritual eyes of understanding was opened. Not to mention spiritual, sorry. Similarly, eyes means eyes of understanding in the Bible. The church should be having eyes of understanding. Even the understanding of God's will. Lucifer did not have this character in him. Though he had all the 9 qualities. 100%. He did not have this eyes of understanding God's will. He misunderstood God's purpose in his life. In permitting him in such a humbling experience. So as to be somebody's watchman. But the church should have these eyes of understanding. They should recognize in their life that nothing in their life is an accident. Everything is permitted by the will of the Lord in our life. The Bible says, even the very hairs of your head are numbered. Can you number your hairs? We can't. But God is numbering. That means He is monitoring even the smallest thing of our life. The things which we don't care is cared by God. Bible also says a bird doesn't fall to the ground without the Father's permission. A sparrow doesn't fall to the ground. Without the Father's permission. If you are eating a turkey, it is by the will of the Lord. He has to give you permission to eat. Or else you can't even touch it. Just imagine, God is giving so much importance to a small sparrow. What about our life? God knows what is best in our life. Whatever He permits, it is for our good. In the Bible it says in Zechariah that he that touches you touches the apple of my eye. We can't even dare to touch the apple of our own eye. Forget about thinking to test the God's eyes. This understanding of God's will, each and every member of the church should be having. This is the seventh stone. The eighth stone is beryl. Beryl means wisdom. Therefore, in the Bible, the church is compared to wise virgins. The ninth stone is topaz. The grace of the Holy Spirit. We should manifest the life of Christ in our life. Even in our words and actions. The tenth stone is Chrysophrasus. This stone is the hardest stone apart from diamond. Similarly, what is the quality of a good soldier? What does the Bible say? Read Timothy. 2 Timothy, 2nd chapter, 3rd verse. 2 Timothy, 2nd chapter, 3rd
verse.
You should endure hardness. As a good soldier of Christ, we should have the capacity and the ability to bear every trial and harden ourselves against evil. Lucifer did not have this character within him. He could not endure such trials in his life. It was very shameful experience for him. Therefore, he filled himself with violence. And defiled his sanctuary and sinned against God. Defiled his body and sinned against God. The 11th stone is Jacinth. Jacinth means defenders of faith. And the last stone, 12th stone is Amethyst. This stone was an antidote for drinking. It was believed that a wine drunk out of a cup of amethyst would not intoxicate. This stone had the ability to purify. Similarly, if we want to be of the church class, we need to have this purifying effect upon others. We should not only help ourselves to overcome and make our calling and election sure, but we should also help others to overcome their weaknesses and help them to make their calling and election sure. Satan did not have this quality in him. He not only got defiled, he defiled everybody. In Canada, in Canary, there is a proverb. Koti taan kedarale vana ella kedastante. Okay, I'll tell you. Monkey not only got spoiled himself, but he spoiled the whole garden, it seems. Monkey not only got spoiled himself. But if we want to be of the body of the high priest, and help the mankind during the 1,000 years, we should be able to understand them and help them to overcome their weaknesses and come back to that Adamic perfection. This purifying effect the church should be having within them. So these are the 12 qualities the church is having. Jasper, perfection. Sapphire, faithfulness. Chalcedony, submission. Emerald, everlasting life. Sardonyx, humble and holy. Sardis, love. Chrysolite, understanding the will of God. Beryl, wisdom. Topaz, grace and kindness. Chrysophrasus, endure the hardness as a good soldier of Christ. Jacinth, defenders of faith. Amethyst, capability to purify and cleanse others of their sin. Lucifer, even after having all these 9 qualities, fell into sin. Why? Because of one thing. that is pride. We might be having all the 12 qualities. But if we are having pride within us, definitely we will also fail. Lucifer was faithful for how many years? Minimum of 42,000 years. We are faithful to God how many years? Not even 42 years. But yet God has promised us to give the divine nature. How precious is that opportunity? We will not get this opportunity again and again in our life. We will not get this opportunity again and again in our life. Let us all humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God so that He may exalt us in His due time. Dear brethren, we have a beautiful example of Moses. Moses led nearly 60 lakh Jews. Led 30 lakh Jews. 30 lakhs. Israelites. Jews out of Egypt. Such a mighty man. With single-handed, he controlled the Israel people. Did he go to Canaan? Did he go to the promised land? Why? Why? Tell me. He did not praise the Lord. Little bit of pride. Just imagine. God did not even care for Moses. He just cast him off. What are we in His sight? We are all unprofitable servants. After all the work, we should say, as Jesus taught us, that we are unprofitable servants. Luke 17 chapter. In the brother, 7 to 8, brother. Hebrew. Luke 17 chapter. 10th verse. Luke 17:10.
Taki wy, gdy uczyńcie wszystko, co wam polecono, mówcie. Sługami nieużytecznymi jesteśmy, bo co winniśmy byli uczynić. Bo co winniśmy byli uczynić, uczyniliśmy.
So likewise you, when you shall have done all those things which are commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. We should have this thought always in our mind. I thank my Heavenly Father and my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for giving an unprofitable servant like me this opportunity to serve His little flock. May we all pray that we remain humble in the sight of God. May Lord add His blessings to the understanding of His own words. Thank you.